Hello everyone. So I'll be speaking on some of the work which we have been doing in the area of obesity and male infertility using two obese rat models. So obesity, as we know, that it is associated with severe metabolic and reproductive complications both in men and women. And it has earlier studies have shown were more focused on women fertility with relation to obesity, but now over the last decade, it has been established as a risk factor for male infertility. It is associated with hypogonadism, increase in estrogen, there is reduced androgen, the reduction in sperm function, and increase in sperm damage. However, the data from different studies are conflicting. Some shows there is an effect, some studies show there is no effect. And there is also a transitional effect on the metabolic and reproductive processes. So male obesity, one of the factors which could through which male obesity could affect fertility is by epigenetic mechanisms. And studies have shown that in human, cord blood from newborn of obese parents have altered methylation pattern of imprinted genes. And they further studied that this altered pattern of imprinted genes were also seen in the spermatozoa of the obese father. Surgery-induced weight loss was associated with a dramatic remodeling of sperm DNA methylation and histone positioning and folding RNA expression. Am I audible?
Yes,
hello.
Yes, you are, doctor.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Animal studies have shown that high-fat diet-induced obesity affects metabolic and reproductive functions over two subsequent generations, and this is through modulation of sperm mRNA content and testicular as well as spermatozoa methylation status. So obesity, we know, is multifactorial disorder with predominantly genetic and environmental. Environmental is mainly the diet as causes. And varying effects which we have seen with of male obesity on the endocrine parameters, sperm function, and on epigenetic changes in both rodents and humans could be either due to genetic or environmental factors or a combination of these factors. No studies have found the impact of genetic and high-fat diet-induced obesity on the epigenetic changes in the male germline. So we try to study the epigenetic changes, and we, along with that, we have also studied endocrine, biochemical, and epigenetic changes, which is mainly DNA methylation in the male germline in two obese rats. One is diet induced, and the other is genetically inherited obese rat model. So, for the genetically obese inherited, we use the BIN-OB rat, which is maintained at our sister institute in Hyderabad for National Institute of Nutrition. The features, this was actually way back in 90s, it was a spontaneous mutation and they had got this, and they have been since then maintained at the institute. This, the features were, they were hyperphagic, hyperinsulinemia, increase in triglyceride, high body fat, and they were leptin resistance, but they were euglycemic. And the diet induced, we also use the Vistar rat because this is derived from, the genetic was derived from the Vistar rats. So we had two study groups. One is diet-induced obese group and the other is genetically inherited obese group. So for simplification, I will call this a DIO and this is GIO. So here we had two groups, control and high-fat diet group. And this year we had three groups, lean, WIN-OB, and calorie-restricted. We included this calorie-restricted group only to rule out confounding factors because we wanted to study the effect of obesity on male fertility. So to rule out confounding factors of the mutation, CROB was included. And what was done, how was calorie restriction was the amount of diet which is consumed by the lean control was fed to the WIN-OB rat. When the rat, since the rats were 35 days old, and to in order to achieve calorie restriction. So this is our study experimental protocol. This is the DIO group and the GIO group. So from day one of age, the male rats were fed with either high-fat diet or a controlled diet. For high-fat diet, we had used for around 40 kilocal percent fat for 16% fat. And for control, we had fed 16.5 kilocal fat for 16 weeks. even the GIO group, all the three subgroups were fed with a controlled diet. After 16 weeks, when the rats became adult, we did the fertility studies, biochemical and the hormonal profile was done. We could do in the DI group the embryos, studies with the embryos. However, we were not able to do it with this because this we know we did not produce any litters. So DNA methylation, DNMT's expression was done, cell-specific 5-methylcytosine content was seen in the testes as well as in the caudal spermatozoa. And in the caudal spermatozoa, we also did NGS-targeted methylome sequencing. And the resorbed embryos and the normal embryos were used to see the expression of the differentially methylated genes from the spermatozoa. So to show this, if you see the body weight, there was an increase in body weight in both the groups and they were at a similar extent. And if you see the adipose tissue is a measure of fat content, you see it is increased with respect to the controls. And here also you could see it is there is a significant increase with respect to controls. But what was interesting to see is in the GIO group, the adiposity index was almost 4 times to that of the DIO group, to the HFD group. And even after calorie restriction, though the weight of the body weight had come to almost to mean control, the fat fed was decreased significantly, but it was still higher than the lean counterparts. If you see the biochemical profile, the cholesterol, triglyceride, and LDL was high. Glucose was not affected in any group. And it was also high in the Winobi group, as well as in the calorie restriction group, it was higher than the lean counterparts. So suggesting thereby that with calorie restriction, there is still the metabolic profile is still not come to normal. And you see hormonal profile, you see the reproductive hormones as well as the metabolic hormones. There was a decrease in FSH and prolactin was increased, whereas estradiol was also increased as has been seen in literature. While the other LH and testosterone were not affected in the DI group. However, all these hormones were affected in the GIO group. And what you could interestingly see is with the calorie restriction, the hormones came to normal levels. For the metabolic hormones like insulin, leptin, you could see there was an increase in both the groups, in the DIO as well as the GIO group. And with calorie restriction, though it had decrease, but it was still significantly higher than the lean counterparts. So suggesting that the reproductive performance may, with calorie restriction, the reproductive performance may come to normal. However, the metabolic performance parameters are still higher. So this is fertility parameters where we could see that there was a decrease in litter size and increase in embryo loss, which was also seen in the CROB. So with the WinoB, we could not see any litter because this rats were not able to mate. The potency was decreased. And with the calorie restriction, there was improvement in the fertility parameters. And even in the potency, which had become 100%. So this is to sum up whatever we had got, that there was an increase in adiposity and it was much higher in the GIO group. There were the hormonal parameters were affected, the spermatogenesis was affected, and so do the spermatozoa was affected, and which could have affected the fertility in the two cases. So we know the diet plays a critical role in modulating the epigenome. We further assess the changes in DNA methylation in the male germline of these two obese groups. So what we did was we did the DNA methylation enzymatic machinery we did, which methylates the DNA. The maintenance methylation, which is done by DNMT1, and de novo is done by DNMT3A, 3B, and 3L. So we could see that this is a DI group and this is a GI group. The DI group, there's only a decrease in DNMT1, but the other DNMTs were not affected. In the GIO, all the DNMTs were increased in the the expression of DNMT. This is transcript expression of the DNMTs. There was an increase in the GIO group. And when we try to see in the different testicular cell types, these are spermatids, which are haploid cells. These are 2N, which compose of the spermatogonia as well as the somatic cells in the testes. Then you have the S phase, and these are the premeiotic cells. So you could see that there was a decrease in the 5-methylcytosine content in all these cell types in the DIO group. However, they were not affected in the GIO group. While we could see that there was a decrease in the caudal spermatozoa, decrease in the 5-methylcytosine content in the caudal spermatozoa, while there was an increase in the GIO group. This is in the DIO group and this is in the GIO group. So GIO group, there was an increase, while DIO group, there was a decrease in the 5-methylcytosine content in the spermatozoa. So we tried to do targeted methyl whole genome sequencing in the spermatozoa. These are the by Illumina platform, and these are the different differentially methylated genes, hyper and hypo, both we could get hyper and hypomethylated genes. These are the total number of differentially methylated CpG sites. And what we could see was majority of those differentially methylated CpG sites were mapped in the intergenic and the intronic region for all the groups, suggesting thereby that this could be affecting the gene regulation, expression of gene expression. And we did pathway analysis for the differentially methylated genes. Metabolic pathway was the first to come, and this could be because of the obesity related. But what we could see, and there were other pathways, and down the thing, we could see that there were some pathways which were of developmental importance, which were important for embryogenesis, like the Wnt signaling, the TGF-beta signaling, Knot signaling, and Hedgehog. So we tried to study the genes which were enriched, differentially methylated in this pathways in the spermatozoa. We tried to validate them in the demethylation pattern in the spermatozoa, and then the expression in the embryos. So these are the different pathways in the. These are the different pathways. So we could see that there were the number of genes which were differentially methylated in both the GIO and the DIO group. This is the GIO group and this is the DIO group. And we could see that some of the genes in this pathway overlap in both the groups, but however, the position of the CpG methylation was different. And this is just to show that how this different pathways play a role during embryogenesis. They are important for embryo development, body axis patterning, cell fate specification, cell migration, proliferation, organogenesis, regeneration, and likewise. And what was also interesting was when there was a knockdown of some of these genes upstream or downstream of this pathway, it was associated with embryonic lethality, suggesting the critical role during embryo development. So this is a Wnt pathway which we are then in the spermatozoa. This is the NGS data where it is showing these are hypermethylated. These are the gene names. This is hypermethylation and this is hypomethylation. And it was validated by pyrosequencing. Some of these which were in arrows above validated by pyrosequencing. And we could see that it confirmed with the NGS data. So wherever you see hypomethylation, you see decrease in also in the pyrosequencing. Likewise, you can see here also that there is an increase in hypermethylation, and you could see increase in methylation here, as well as here you could see an increase in methylation. Then we know that the sperm epigenome is important for embryogenesis. So we tried to see, correlate the methylation pattern of these genes in the embryos. And this is what we see in the embryos. We see that in the, this is resorbed embryos and this is the normal embryos. So in the rodents, you have the embryos, the aborted embryos remain in the uterus till term, and unlike the humans where it is aborted. And this is the resorbed, and they are called as resorbed embryos, and this is the normal embryos. So you could see that wherever there was hypomethylation in the spermatozoa, you could see increased expression, and wherever there was decrease increase in the methylation, there you could see decreased expression. It's correlating with the methylation in the spermatozoa, but this was not correlated. The normal embryos expression did not correlate with that of the methylation pattern in the spermatozoa. This is the win obvious. We could not do any embryo studies. So here we have done it, validated it by pyrosequencing. The NGS data was validated and the genes shown by arrow were validated and they confirmed the NGS data. So this is the hedgehog pathway. And you could see. Hedgehog pathway, where you could see that we studied these three genes. We studied the methylation of this gene by pyrosequencing, and we could see that the methylation, there was a decrease in methylation, which confirmed the NGS data. And we could see that the methylation correlated with the expression of the genes in the resorbed embryos, but not in the normal embryos. So these are resorbed embryos where you could see that decrease hypomethylation, and there is an increase in expression. Wherever you see hypermethylation, increase in methylation, you could see a decrease in expression. But this was not seen in the normal embryos. This is in the GIO group where we just validated those different genes with the viral sequencing, and it confirmed with the NGS data. This is the TGF beta pathway where we had studied three genes, and we could see that and one of the genes was validated by pyrosequencing, which showed a decrease. However, it was not significant, and the methylation of the, in the spermatozoa correlated with the methylation in the resorbed embryos, but not in the normal embryos, except this, which was also correlating with the expression of methylation status of this gene. So this is TGF beta in the GIO pathway where we validated these two genes, and it confirmed the NGS data. So not signaling pathway, we studied these four genes, and we could see that when this gene was validated, it was a decrease, but it was not significant. But however, the expression of this gene expression correlated with the methylation pattern in the resorbed embryos, but not in the normal embryos. And this is notch in the GIO group where we could see the, we could validate whatever we saw in the NGS data by pyrosequencing. So to sum up, what we have is we have two types of obesity, diet induced and genetically inherited. And we could see that they were similar in body weights. However, the DNMT, the DNA methylation machinery was different, differentially affected in both the groups, thereby affecting the sperm epigenome, and some of the Wnt pathways were affected, which could have affected the embryogenesis, leading to fertility defects. So this is just summary in brief. It differentially reprogrammed DNA methylation profile of genes or developmental pathways in spermatozoa. Expression pattern of the genes associated with the development pathways in resorbed embryos, but not in the normal embryos, correlated with the methylation pattern in the spermatozoa DIA group. And sperm methylome is involved in early embryogenesis. So work was done by my doctoral student, Sharvari Deshpande. And we had a collaboration for the genetically obvious with Dr. Harishankar Nirmani from National Institute of Nutrition, Hyderabad. The directors of both institutes are acknowledged. The funding was intramural funding from NIRH. and the sequencing and data analysis was done by Dr. Gandhimathi and Dr. Avinash from Genotypic Analysis. Thank you.